not trying to be a good person. I think that such a distinction is confusing. I'm not trying to be a bad person either, and obviously this ancient dichotomy implies that there are good or bad people. A good person who somehow cannot ever make a mistake, or a bad person who is incapable of ever doing any good at all. The truth is, in every moment there are decisions and the consequences of those decisions, all of which add up to what is happening right now, good, bad, or both. I believe that by committing actions harmonious with my circumstances and cohesive to the other wonderful decision makers around, we improve our experience together. All cacophonic actions create predictable and often unsurprising amounts of suffering, and in so seeking this harmony, I intend to, and have before, experienced successes unprecedented, unpredicted successes not of my own creation or even within the realm of my imagination. By not sowing, but by collaborating with the sowers and reapers, synchronizing with not my own fear-based goals, but the world I am intrinsically composed of and therefore incredibly connected to. The less fear, the less ego, the less I worry about living improperly, the more life is living through me, as me, and me as life, all effortlessly on the same synchronized wavelength as much as possible. That is what harmony is. Or so at least is the point of all this. My name is Gold Vision, and I am a digital pacifist. To this particular game, I brought an NVIDIA 2070 i9 and my co-conspirator, Jen.
Hi.
Who could thankfully serve as a sounding board during our livestream of the first hour of gameplay, as well as a witness who could validate my claims and help out with customization. All too often, I have allowed a poorly or hastily or randomly designed character novel at first end up discouraging me from continuing their story, and so I made sure to create a person who I would enjoy strolling through the purported future with. After a quick randomization, I developed something of a handsome Santa ilk, who we thought might in the off-season pivot his trade to a spokesperson of a cyber toothpaste brand, and made sure to choose appropriate teeth for that hopeful career path. Although I often fall victim to min-maxing when I should have been max-minning out of the gate and often off a cliff, I allocated an remarkably balanced amount of techno points.
I'm gonna be slightly smarter than I am cool.
Most of which I didn't understand the value or purpose of, instead accepting the whole point of harmony to stay pretty centered with my digital toothpaste wanderer, and we all stepped out into the world of Cyberpunk 2077. The initial story world was bugged. I had not updated my drivers recently, and as such would suffer an omniforest, always present, as if my character could somehow sense trees and plant life in any direction they looked. Honestly, a superpower if you'll allow that, but it was annoying anyway, and not willing to end the livestream just to learn the proper method of unbiting this radioactive spider, I decided to drag everyone through it, hoping perhaps a scene change or location change or hotkey would resolve my momentarily distracting power. Some early fun inciting incident interactions left us to understand my character had a checkered or backered past, I guess, and also I was capable of performing the HDMI cable hot switch of future cars. I would become reliant on my character's competence in this world, so I would assume with his level of automotive expertise he's also learned to drive, but I hadn't, and so it was clear that this world would become a mutual effort, myself trying to synchronize with my avatar's competence, doing things that would allow our worlds to provide us with the best experiences possible. Something something tower, something something switch, something something Jackie, we met future navigator and cyberpunk man whose body language and brandished firearm I openly embraced.
This guy looks like a bad guy.
Jackie would give us some vague conversation about the legality of a transport mission he wanted us to participate in. On one hand, I felt free to leave. I was with Carr and free to explore the world, and Jackie had suggested enough to let me know he'd be crossing some lines. But I also knew who I was, who I wanted to be, and was willing to walk in the paths the universe had provided, and permanently etched into my eyes, apparently, as long as I didn't have to attack or hurt anyone. This, of course, went as bad as it could have. I'll spare you the tree vision as we fudged our way through and out of and back into the authority of customs, into what became an apparent low-road supercut. The escalating risks I personally wasn't engaging in but was bearing witness to encouraged me to skip the rest, and from my perspective, any activity that happened in other people's games that did not happen here did not happen here. Immediately leaving the cutscene, Jackie and I are seamlessly, choicelessly whisked into the parking garage of the first mission, a request to find a missing person somewhere within a high-tech, or I guess regular-tech, apartment building. Jackie wanted to make sure I played some AR gunplay video game in preparation of whatever was going to transpire. A USB drive I politely refused because, as he probably knows, I have been trying not to kill people in video games. Instead, I opted to play the elevator minigame, pressing one of two buttons to go from the garage to the other accessible floor.
Oh, I've got a phone call.
target's Sandra Dorsett.
We're informed over the phone by an apparent co-worker, T-Bug, that we are currently looking for Sandra Dorsett, a potential missing person. I did hope to find our target and protect them, but at this point I felt trapped by Jackie and the mission, and now after that mischievous montage, I was hoping to escape the business aspect of our relationship as amiably and quickly as possible. We walk down the hallway to our door, and I am presented with the option to open it. It's difficult at this time for me to know the repercussions of doing this activity, the ethics of missing people, the legal repercussions, but at this point I'm still willing to go along with the narrative as long as I don't have to actually hurt anyone. I accept that my character has begun their journey in the middle of an unfortunate path, and am willing to commit gray area actions, especially to resolve conflict surrounding a missing person, even though the legality here is likely suspect. I honestly don't know the rules of the world in the future, and even Aladdin stole some bread on the way to marry a princess.
This is the hostel area. Not here to cause any trouble, I think. Tell him I gotta use the restroom.
You just cough, you know, or like scoop your sneaker.
Ahem. Excuse me. Break. Good isn't the first word. Have you? Yeah. Gotta step out. Step on out up here. I hope Jackie gets the hint.
Yeah, should we let him know?
Is our radio?
With you in a sec!
There we go. Nobody got hurt. Hey, Jackie, come on.
Jackie,
come on out.
Come on. You were
come on out
there.
Of there. You don't need to. You guys need to relax.
Get your bro.
We get out in the hallway where we get snooty about Jackie's ammo policies.
He's just, he fires one shot and reloads both guns.
Each time.
I hack a fan.
They're so distracted.
And then a person.
I'm gonna try this one out. What?
And then a computer, but none of these hacks distract the angry people in this room enough to get them to stop attacking me, or the wall in the furthest room of the apartment. In fact, that wall actually became a passageway to a secret room. It took a few more attempts, sandwiched in a save point between the angry scavengers, a destroyable wall, and a mysterious man who had no interest in introductions. All the doors in my available area had been permanently locked, and the hopelessness of the situation caused me to decide to abandon the stream and reflect on any possible options, possibly even reverting back to a save state before I journeyed with Jackie. I did not, however, give up. I decided to do some exploration on my own, and what ensued was thankfully a non-streamed, six-hour endeavor of trying to get to the back room to find Sandra Dorsett. The basic principles at work here are my desire to avoid participating in the contest of violence, allowing the violent nature of reality and all of its constituents to combat themselves, leaving no traceable impact or indication that I was a participant in destruction. Of course, before direct action, the first line I was willing to cross was the possible theft and use of the Mac Stock Mark I inhaler, worth $5 future, and which would replenish 40% of my health bar. I believe the use of an inhaler to survive in an environment whose occupants were attacking me was justified, as I believe I could not be of any use to our society if dead or flatlined, in cyberpunk lingo. As we ran through, somehow not resolving confrontation, Jackie and I maintained a checkpoint within the deeper reach of the apartment, between six armed guards of this variety, I won't say this word in case it's profane, and the breakaway wall leading to a more heavily armed guard who was willing to kill me without proper introduction, a man I assumed was guarding Miss Dorsett. My initial goal in order to get to the back room was to allow the somewhat inaccurate guards to fire at me and Jackie, revealing a safe passageway between an unhackable door. On my second try, I successfully made it into and past the big tank guard, onto what I was hoping was our destination, but what turned out to be a rather unsafe dead-end balcony, from which Jackie would join and attack the scavenger leader with his mega gun that would kill my easy-mode cyber body as if it were a narrative-specific breakable wall. All the doors I could find were also unhackable. Unlike the front door, the technology of which implied my potential breaking and entering crime was much less of a faux pas than I had feared. If doors could be unhackably locked, then it would imply whatever I did here was just some sort of captcha. I also spent some time trying to escape via fast travel on the map screen, and some more time trying to learn any method or levels that might let me hack a door, but it seemed no level of cool was going to allow me to break out of the doors triggered by the defeat of these door-specific guardians. Hacking them in themselves to blind them or injure seemed like some Geneva Convention implications with no permanent resolution, so I would avoid that, while distracting them by hacking their computers or ceiling fan had seemingly no impact on their chosen lifestyles either. So I resolved to begin a less invasive investigation, allowing Jackie to do what Jackie is inclined to do. I'm not responsible for Jackie's action, and I respect him as a person, not for what he does. But as I respect my assailants and all sentience, our potentials for good, and instead of joining them, I thought I would wait for them to resolve the equation of violence until everything was cancelled out. I waited 2.5 hours, Jackie training gunshots with what I would later learn was one of the two guards free to roam away from the center room, and after I finished my coffee, I realized that neither of them had lost any health from when they'd started. As it turns out, Jackie was immortal, someone whose weapon was merely for pyrotechnic display. The only method he could employ to actually combat another was his own brand of special leaping punch. This launch would ever so slightly reduce our mutual assailants' health bars, and was the only way anyone around here was making any progress at all. If Jackie wasn't hitting them with the material parts of the gun, they would all continue to impotently trade fire forever. I continued to look for a solution to this problem, and in so doing, attracted the attention of the two wandering guards, who chased me out of the apartment down the hall. Jackie, of course, came with the party and rehearsed his words of encouragement as I stood cramped in a corner trying to hold on to the little health points I had left. I don't know if it was because of how much time had passed, but the lobby and various parts of this place of business suddenly started to teem with all kinds of health-restoring tools. I'd carry so much as 9 at a time, which I would use to replenish the reserves I would lose to the various warriors in their crusades. It wasn't my decision to engage in combat or whatever this was, and now, having entered it, I had every intention of parting ways with my compatriots as soon as I was allowed to walk montage-free in the open world again, all intentions of heading to my initial futurist destination. For literal hours, Jackie would do his disco dives, and I would patiently disco wait as the violence inclined to resolve their conflicts. I'd eventually try to contact the outside world through the web portal available on several unlocked machines, but they appeared to be on strange proprietary intranet for local research purposes only, and I couldn't reach out to any sort of authority, although even then, I don't know if their violence resolution preferences would align with my health bar or not. As Jackie's did, I snuck him over to the breakaway room, having successfully hidden from the 4 main room guards. I escorted the demigod to the room with the mission-specific leader, a man armed with a cannon and ammunition seemed more suited for interior renovations. I avoided him long enough to lose his interest, and eventually Jackie would punch him until something went wrong and he exploded, a fate I had been trying to spare the 4 remaining guards. But alas, this was no snake with its head cut off, but some kind of multi-headed snake. The mission required the defeat of all antagonists to advance, defeat meaning depletion of their health bar, and possibly not death, as our opponents seemed to writhe on the ground indefinitely after Jackie hit them enough, unless of course they exploded. The resulting chess game of moving within Jackie's response area, allowing him to combat pawn by pawn, sometimes taking crossfire, used up all but one of my health tools in the process. It was unfortunately dicey, and I knew if I had to do it all over again, I probably could cut the time down considerably, but I was hoping to complete this leg of the mission and escape the confines of our incompatible relationship as soon as possible. After the defeat of the last combatant, a complete transformation takes place. T-Bug chirps in, telling us the rooms are secure as if no time had passed at all, which if we're looking at the user interface seems to be true. Jackie finally moves to new conversational material, and I find gains to my athletics trait, probably from the marathon worth of scurrying needed to get to this point. Overall, I'd spent over 6 hours on this first mission, often simply waiting for the world to do as it must. This world is a violent place. I'm not responsible for that, or the violence caused by others. I'm not in a position of power, I am not an elected official, and I'm not financially secure, although for some reason I found myself intertwined with a person who socially benefits from the contest's violence, I've not made the choice to conduct myself that way. Upon learning of Jackie's methods, I've wished to part ways, but not before we find out if Sandra Dorset was alright, and if the story would have me, Cold Vision, the digital pacifist.